I promised a promo. I guess I promised a promo for 3 o'clock. 3 o'clock came up. 3 o'clock came quickly. But here, we're on the air. This is Ham Radio Now. That wasn't right. Oh. I think I know what happened. I turned off the green screen chroma key for that. Beba, I'm on the air. Okay, baby doesn't know what I'm on the air means. Hang on a second. She says, how am I supposed to know you're on the air? And I say, well, you don't until I holler, I'm on the air. And then she says, oh, have fun. Okay, so meanwhile, this thing, it's supposed to be a chroma key. I turned it off so I could show David what the deal was. And now, oh, and so I'll show you what the deal is. See up here. Here on the Wirecast, it can be chroma key or not. And I had it in not. So now, try one more time. Boom. Okay, there we go. This has been a pretty busy weekend. Lots of stuff happening. Thought we were just going to talk about quartzite and stuff. And I'm waiting just in case David shows up on the Zoom, but he hasn't texted back that he's anywhere out there, so I needed to get this done and go on to a couple other things, and then we'll do a show tonight. So yes, we're going to do a show tonight. Boom. That is what promises we do a show tonight. Live Sunday, 7 p.m. Pacific, 10 p.m. Eastern, 3 p.m. Zulu, technically Monday morning for the Zulu. So, and what is that show going to be? Because it's been a busy weekend. David and Jim are out at quartzite. Last we saw, they were driving out into the desert. I have seen some pictures since then, so I know they got back from the desert, but as far as the show is concerned, they ended up in the desert, never heard from again. So we'll see. Let's see. Oh, yes. And then well, let me show you what I'm... Ah, there. And there's David. Yay, there's David. Let's turn David's audio message on. Your audio's on.
I'm on. Can you hear me now?
I can hear you
now. Sorry, I missed the message. I've been running around doing stuff to get ready for shows later on.
Okay, we're on the air, so.
Hello.
Because I promised for everybody a 3 o'clock promo. I don't know if anybody's watching or not.
Yeah, and actually, I got to go on to the next thing, but I was just checking in to do some paperwork, and I said, oh, look, there's a message.
Yep.
So, 7 o'clock.
So, yeah, 7 o'clock specific time.
Yep. I've been doing stuff to get ready for shows later on.
Okay. We're
I saw me.
I'm messing myself up.
Well, that's right.
Yeah. Is anybody watching? 7 people are watching now. So, yeah.
Hello, seven of you.
We'll
be back
group.
In 7 hours.
Yeah.
Plus or minus.
Yeah. So, I wanted to show people the title that I'm coming up for the show because... This is kind of interesting. Like I said, it's been a busy weekend. You guys are back from the desert, apparently.
Mm-hmm. I don't know if Jim's back today, I think.
Okay, so he stuck around for a while. So I have a quartzite report.
Well, he's got an extra drive because he brings his 26-foot home along with him.
Which is what you guys stayed in?
Or home away from home. What's that?
What you guys stayed in?
Yes.
Yeah, I bet that was fun. We're looking forward to a full report, but... Here's what the title is for today's show.
Ta-da.
The Angry Radio Relay League. There's stuff up in the air.
Yep.
And it's not fun. This is not the fun ham radio that we like to have, where we play and talk on a radio and stuff. But it's, I believe it's got to be done. There's stuff up at the league.
Yep.
Is this
us or with a guest?
I believe we will have a guest. We'll have a director a famous, well-known director on the show. Will you have some video from the director you recorded over the
Like to share that video, but it's over an hour long, so I'm not sure it would be part of the episode. I'm going to do a little, I'll do a little promo and post it up there as a bonus episode. Or
you know what they do on the news? They edit. They take an hour long talk and they bring a minute out of it.
Yeah. Okay.
And there's, there's probably a minute or two out of that Dick Norton, the N6AA, the director from out west, as close as I can come, the director from out west had some things to say about the recent ARRL board meeting. A director from out east has some things to say about the ARRL board meeting and the ARRL, and the ARRL has some things to say about that director. And it's all
live, 10 p.m. Eastern.
Yeah, tonight. And then and then there's that, what I've been working on, what I was working on all weekend was my TikTok thing.
I saw you had posted two. I've seen two so far.
Yeah, we've got a TikTok channel. Yay. I made it a while ago because I stuck, before Christmas, I stuck the Ham's Night Before Christmas up there. But then after talking to Glam Ham Natalie, I was inspired to make a little production.
I enjoyed it.
It may have been an audition. I'm not sure.
An audition.
It's an audition. No, it's not. It's not going to get me anywhere, but it was fun to do. So it's on the YouTube channel. It's on the Facebook. It's everywhere. But we also have the TikTok now for whatever we're going to do with it, which is probably nothing anymore ever. I put the TikTok app on my phone. It is so annoying.
You didn't like that.
It's relentless. It does not stop. You tell it to stop, and then a second later, it's starting again. Mm-hmm. Did you put TikTok on your phone? Different on the web.
Yeah, it's on my phone. It's different. It's a different experience. I think that's what the kids are interested in.
Yeah. I mean, it just comes at you and at you and at you. But you can tell it. You can tell it to tell me to back off after whatever period of time you want, 5 hours.
How many hours did it take to get there for you, Gary?
You just saw that
it was an option.
I saw it was an option. I haven't said it yet. Got it. Yeah. And TikTok is showing me random stuff right now because it doesn't know who I am yet. So we'll see.
I think from what I understand is after they figure out who you are, they'll still show you random stuff.
Yeah, people have told me that it will start recognizing what I like, but I got to tell it what I like. And so far, I don't really like anything. So, except for
you're going to get random stuff for a while.
Yeah, it does show. I like the Glam Ham, so it shows me all her stuff.
Right.
Yeah. All right. So you got to go.
I have stuff I got to do. So back in almost 7 hours, I'll be on a little bit. I will. See you then.
David is not highly enthusiastic about the promo. We're not going to hit promo territory.
I got stuff to do and I wanted to come and say hi and we'll be back.
Okay. I'll stick around for a minute.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah. You have fun.
Yeah.
As long as you want. This could be totally a promo. It just won't be a promo with me.
It could become a promo, but probably it won't.
Okay.
All right. See you later.
See you later. Bye.
So, let's see, turn it down. Yeah, I guess let's go take a look at the TikTok channel. TikTok. I don't know how to spell. TikTok. No, I-K. There we go. TikTok.com. I'll show you two in a minute. Okay, there's... Yeah, there's us. Okay, take the Sunday thing off so you can see it all. And two things. There's the Harry Potter thing. Why don't I play that? 41 people have seen it on TikTok already. That's pretty cool.
This is Ham Radio. Okay, start the music, Gary.
This is Ham Radio. I don't think I did that right.
So we're going to just move right on. This is Ham Radio Now, episode number 461.
The most important amateur radio program on the internet. I am Gary Pierce, K4AAQ, the King of Ham.
And I'm David Goldenberg, W0DHG.
I'm Natalie Gray, a.k.a. Glam Ham Radio on TikTok. And my call sign is November Whiskey 6 Sierra. And I am coming to you from behind the Hollywood sign in Los Angeles. I was scouted by Warner Brothers for this incredible project, which I haven't been allowed to speak about for nearly 6 years. And I can finally tell you, I've been a writer on Hogwarts Legacy, which is an amazing, epic video game that's set in the Wizarding World. And it comes out February 10th.
You're sitting in the writer's room and you introduce the line, and Harry picks up his bowfire. It was a dark and stormy night, because of course it was. And it was a showdown between Harry Potter and his arch enemy, the evil Lord Voldemort. And on this night, Voldemort had the upper hand. He was raising his wand and about to utter an incantation that might spell the end of Potter once and for all. You know the word. I just can't bring myself to repeat it. Potter reached for his wand to defend himself, but it was nowhere to be found. Voldemort had torn it from Potter's hand with the Expelliarmus spell just moments before. But Potter had one last trick up his sleeve, or on his belt, to be more accurate. He reached down and grabbed his trusty Baofeng handy-talkie, the one with the extra capacity battery and the extended length rubber duck antenna. That rubber duck had actually selected Harry rather than the other way around. He had acquired it from the secret radio shack in the back of Ollivander's wand shop in Diagon Alley in London, where it had practically leapt from the shelf onto Potter's radio after scrounging an adapter because it had actually been designed for a Yaesu radio. Pulling the Baofeng from his belt, Harry Potter quickly tuned it to the most powerful repeater in all the land, the repeater that sat high on the summit of Mount Belzoni, with solid coverage of the entire metropolitan area, and well beyond. Potter raised the Baofeng to meet Voldemort's level and firmly pressed the push to talk. Electrons rushed from the bowels of the extra-capacity battery, converted themselves to RF in the oscillator circuit, and were amplified to a full 8 watts in the final transistor before coursing down the extended-length rubber duck antenna and leaping out in a burst of radio frequency energy the likes of which Potter had never experienced. Before Voldemort could complete his spell, the radio signal from Potter's Baofeng handy-talkie crossed the space between them, striking the evil wizard square in the chest. Voldemort dropped his wand and was knocked flat on his evil wizard arse. Harry Potter, with his 8-watt Baofeng handy-talkie with the extra-capacity battery and the extended rubber duck antenna, had won, because of course they had.
This is Ham Radio. Okay, start the music.
That's Ham Radio. Stop it. That's what I mean about.
Just move right on. This is Ham Radio.
That's what I mean about TikTok. It does not stop. It does not stop by itself. Not there. It's going to play that over and over again. Why am I complaining about that? Sounds like a good idea to me. Okay, let's see what you guys are up to. On the show. Anybody on the show? Yeah, Pat, W3RJA, more league drama. No, I'm not clickbaiting you. I'm not. There is more league drama. I don't want to do that show yet. I want to do that show tonight when we have the guests on to do that show. But what David was referring to in the talk from Dick Norton, which is already out there, don't know if anybody else has published it yet. We'll probably publish the whole thing. And maybe try for a couple of clips tonight. I don't know if David has a chance to edit them. Is that there's a schism in the board. There's the transparency side, and there is the secrecy side. And Dick Norton and a few other directors are on the transparency side, but they are outvoted on the board these days. The code of silence, I mean, code of conduct is coming back, maybe. That's where a few years ago, the board passed a code of conduct that said that if you're a board member, if you're a director and the board decides to do something and you disagree with it, you shalt not disagree with it in public. You will not talk about it. Okay, so yeah, coming back, maybe, and other stuff, significant, serious other stuff. I would like to point out that all of the people that are involved in the angry side, well, maybe angry on both sides, I don't know. Everybody is an ARRL supporter. Everyone says ARRL deserves your support, your membership, needs your membership. It is command and control of the ARRL. There's also issues of ARRL management, CEO, things like that. We will get into all that. So tonight at 7 o'clock, we will be presenting essentially one side and not the other. And then maybe we'll get to the other at some point. This won't be a debate. It will be a discussion, not even an investigation, just a discussion. Okay. So what else did the, what else did I see on something on the TikTok here? Somebody, Mr. Twister, who's watching now, I believe, because this just came in a couple minutes ago. I can't make the repeater with a 5-watt Bofeng, which I like to pronounce Bofeng, but I get it wrong. Can I get an 8-watt one? That will surely work. All I know about the 8-watt Bofeng is that it will destroy Voldemort. And by the way, the radio in the graphic was this one, which is, first of all, not an 8-watt. It's technically a Bofeng. It's the BTEC model. It's the tri-band 5X3. But it does have the extra capacity battery and the extended rubber duck. And as you can see, as I hold it in my hand, it does not glow. But that was a little graphics work, a little script work, a little voiceover work, a little audio mixing, all on the part of me, really just to impress Natalie, who probably has not seen it yet, because there's been no reaction. How could Cindy? I'm upstairs. There's a stairway right behind me. You heard Cindy at the beginning of the episode going, baby. She was about to head out, do some errands and stuff. How could she know that I was on the air? I don't have a flashing on the air light that goes on down there. I know what she could do. She could subscribe and have her phone notify when we go live. I don't think I'm going to suggest that to her. I think that would be a bad idea on my part. Now, she's not mad, but I'll have to clear this up. What else have we got? Don't know. I've been prolific as the extreme Elmer, the annoying Elmer. What have I got here in my title? Now, my title's just King of Ham. It's not the annoying Elmer at this point. Answering lots of questions out there. A lot of interesting questions coming down the pike for new hams, GMRS. A lot of it in GMRS. I've been playing with that a bit. Did anybody out there work Winter Field Day? I intended to operate a little bit of it while I was driving around yesterday. And I ended up watching the hour-long director talk that Dick Norton did out at Quartzsite instead, because David fed me the whole thing. So I had about an hour of driving to do yesterday, and that used it all up. So I don't know how busy I wanted to see. What I wanted to see was how busy the bands got. Summer Field Day fills up the bands, except for the 12, 17, It's what people call the work bands. I have a problem calling them the work bands because that was 1978, 79. They're still distinguished, not in any rules of the FCC as anything special. They're still distinguished by the way contests treat them. Typically, contests stay off of them. So 12 meters, 17 meters, 30 meters. That's it, right? Those three. And now 60 meters is not technically a work band. But same thing, you don't contest on 60. So I wanted to see how busy the regular, the non-work bands. I guess we just need a way to distinguish them. I wanted to see how busy they were and tune around. And I 10 meters was open, 15 meters was open. And then at that point, I started watching the talk from Dick, which, by the way, was an interesting but devolved into a kind of a normal ARRL director talk. There's so much media out there. There's so many ways to get information that you go to an ARRL chat, ARRL meeting at a ham fest, and the director just kind of reviews things that are going on that you could already know about. Although, listening to some of the questions that came back to him, it appears that two things, listening to the comments that are coming back to him. One, hams don't know very much about what's going on. And two, even though they don't know very much about what's going on, everybody has an idea of how to fix things, and they want to tell the director. Maybe that's two subsets of people within the group, and I didn't see how big a group that was. The camera never panned over and looked at everybody. So he talked about routine stuff, but he also talked about this dichotomy on the board that will be part of what we're discussing tonight. I, being a media type person, mainstream media personality, lean in favor of transparency and openness and discussion, things like that. And it is disturbing to hear folks on the board say they don't want to participate in that. I don't know. Let's see, what else? I have been looking into, does the 118th Congress have the Amateur Radio Emergency Preparedness Act yet? It doesn't appear to be. Everything's still left over from last session. That's one of the things that somebody brought up at Dick's talk. He mentioned the Preparedness Act a little bit. And somebody goes, why do they always? Because that's what hams sound like when they're talking from the audience. Why do they always propose this stuff at the end of a legislative session when it's going to die? You know the answer to that. You know where we came from on that. We asked that question on the show where we talked about the dying old act and the coming new act. They explained. John explained that it was because they wanted legislation, they wanted language, legislative language, official language that they could point to in an attempt to gather co-sponsors. So they're getting their co-sponsors probably now, and that act will be reintroduced. Bill Johnson from Ohio has very much committed that he will reintroduce the act. So it's coming back. But from the point of view of the guy in the audience, it was introduced and that was it. It was done. It was dead. There was no reason for it. And he was asking an apparently rhetorical question. Why do they always introduce it at the end? And Dick didn't actually have a really good answer for that. I don't know if he quite understood the idea. I mean, he did say it's going to be reintroduced, but he didn't say it was introduced late in the session so that they would have the language. I also don't think that he has much hope that this act is going to really go anywhere. I did a minor amount of research into Bill Johnson, the congressman from Ohio. And next time we talk to Fred and John, Fred Hoppengarten and John, lost John's last name, the directors director and former director who were on the committee that crafted the act. Next time I talk to him, I'll ask him about this. Bill Johnson introduces tons of legislation every year. Any congressman can introduce any bill they want. And the only ones that he gets that go anywhere are things like naming post offices. So he's the original sponsor of many bills that don't go anywhere. And most of them don't appear to be particularly controversial. I didn't dig deeply into them. I just looked a little bit. Most of them don't appear to be really controversial, but the ones that get passed by Congress are naming post offices. I'm being unfair because I don't have a list in front of me. I should dig that out a little bit. But my point is that he is not known for someone who gets a lot of substantial stuff done. Well, is this substantial? No. In the course of grand legislation that goes through Congress, this is maybe one step above naming a post office. Okay, maybe two steps above naming a post office. So if he gets this through, it's a bit more than what he typically does. So then you say, well, is that the guy to bring this in? Well, I can't answer that question. Maybe not. I told you I did a little bit of research. I haven't even dug up any footage to see what he sounds like talking to the news media, cameras, and the general public, or any media that he's generated himself. That would be interesting to do. That would be some interesting background to dig out and to see what his legislative process is really like. But he's our guy right now, and that is in progress. And for anybody who was in the audience for Dick Norton's talk out in Quartzsite, yes, there's a reason they introduced it at the end of the last session. And every indication is that it will be coming back. So there's that. Have I got anything else on my plate here? I don't know, because we're seconds away from a promo. When did I start this crazy thing? And we're 27 minutes and 42 seconds in. If we make it to 30 minutes, it's a promo. So once again, the last refuge of a YouTuber is to look at the chat room again. Got somebody named Old Preach on there. Pat is wondering a while ago, Pat W3RJA was wondering if this thing we're talking about with the director is about a book. Yes, that's part of it. About a book. Deja vu. Yes. Deja vu. Old Reach. Bofeng. Beofeng. Yeah. Somewhere in there. Pat says one field day is enough. There we go. That's going to get me over the line for the promore. Hello, RF shortwaves. Good evening from the UK. Okay, from the UK. Hang on to the shortwave field. We've got somebody from the UK. I need you to analyze my accent. I need you to tell me how bad this accent is. Because you weren't on earlier, so I'll play a little bit of this again, and then you can tell me. So let's see. Because of course it was. And it was a showdown between Harry Potter and his arch enemy, the evil Lord Voldemort. And on this night, Voldemort had the upper hand. He was raising his wand and about to utter an incantation that might spell the end of Potter once and for all. You know the word. I just can't bring myself to repeat it.
Okay, so now the question is that terrible? I know it's not good, but how terrible is it? Okay, so I'm waiting for RF Shortwaves to come back and tell me it's working its way through the YouTube, but he's just starting to hear it now, so it's going to come back in a minute. Dick's talk is not on YouTube yet, that I know of, not from us. Other people recorded it, I think. So I haven't gone to search, but it will be. One field day is enough. That was one of the things I think people were talking about in Dick's talk about winter field day and why there should be one. Some folks wanted ARRL to take over winter field day. ARRL sponsors field day, the summer one. And for the first 25 years of my ham radio career, I lived in the north, Chicago area. And field day was in a typically nice, balmy summer day. I mean, even in Chicago, it got hot. Sometimes we had thunderstorms, but for the most part, it was a nice summer day. And then I moved in 1990, I moved to North Carolina. And Dick was saying that he was specifying a couple of spots in the country where field day might be uncomfortable for a small number of hams in late June, in the summertime. They were out in Quartzsite, Arizona. And of course, that's low desert. That's a couple hundred feet above sea level. And in June, late June in Quartzsite, it's going to be 110 degrees. It's going to be 1% humidity, but it's going to be 110 degrees. It's going to be uncomfortable to sit outdoors for a long time. Not too bad if you got shade. I mean, you don't want to do it without shade. I lived in Arizona in the low desert, 500 feet above sea level, for 2.5 years, Lake Havasu City. And I know what Arizona summertime is like, and it can be brutal. Late June, first of all, I was working on a little radio station. I was the morning DJ on KFWJ. And what I learned was that at that point of the year, 110 degrees and 12% relative humidity is a nice, nice summer day. It doesn't start to get bad until it's like 115. In fact, we were told as we were doing the weather forecasts that if it's below 110, we describe the day as warm. We do not say it is hot. We describe the day as warm if it's going to be below 110. So that's not too bad. But that's not the thing with winter field day or summer field day. Now I live in the Carolinas, 30 years in North Carolina, a little bit here in South Carolina. And that's not what we get in the summertime. We get upper 90s, mid to upper 90s, 95% humidity, and a good chance of thunderstorms every day. And so of all my field day activity, and I've been on a field day for almost every year of that 32 years that I've been down here, almost every year, we batten down the hatches and let a thunderstorm roll through for an hour. And then it's usually gone, and we can connect the antennas back up and get back on the air. We cover up the generators because they're going to get drenched and all that stuff. And so my take on that from years in the north and then years in the south was clearly the date for field day was designated by people who think that late June weekend is a balmy, nice, pleasant summer day in most places. Which call zone has the most hams? I think you know this, but this will be the quiz. Which call zone has the most hams? I'm K4 AAQ down here, the 4th district. I think we even beat out the 6th district because we've got a lot more states. But didn't used to be. When I was first on, when I first became a ham up in the 9th call area, 4th was a lazy, sleepy call zone. But everybody's moved down here. And so the 4 goes as far north as Virginia, and that is still the south. No, the 3 area is not. Yeah, 3 area, Pat, is not the not the biggest call area. It's down here. From Virginia down into Florida and west to Tennessee and Kentucky. All that territory more or less has miserable, miserable outdoor weather in the summer. Up in the mountains, gets a little bit nicer. The North Carolina mountains, North Carolina, West Virginia mountains, give you relief from temperature. It gets cooler, but it does not get much less humid. And as they say, it ain't the heat, it's the humidity that gets you. Because again, out in Arizona, 105, 110 degrees, 10, 15% relative humidity, gorgeous day. Just stay out of the sun, the direct sun, and you're going to be okay. So winter field day, for now, what I'm going to call the preponderance of ham radio operators across the length and breadth of these great United States, summer is bad. Winter is better. So anyway, what I don't know is how good the winter field day thing filled up the bands. Somebody at Dick's Talk thought it would be a good idea if the ARRL were to take over and sponsor winter field day as well. And Dick said he'd pass that along. That's not going to happen. There's a group that sponsors it. It seems to be catching on. I don't remember how many years ago it started, probably farther back than I remember, but it seems to be catching on, and people are having fun. There's certainly lots of groups around my area that set up winter field day stations, so they did it. RF Shortwaves in the UK says, I think it's okay. A bit of American comes through, but it's good. I'm flattered and impressed. Yeah, even I can hear the American. It's very hard to get every syllable into the British accent. And I did a couple of takes, but I didn't overthink it. But not too bad. One other person on a previous Ham Radio Now who heard a little snippet of me attempting to do a bad British accent said, you know, it sounds a little German. I don't know. Let's see. They say it's going to be 25C in the UK, but then they say it's going to be warmer when it reaches 30C. That's not warm, that's hot. Yeah, British weather forecasters are not that great. You guys got humidity too. You don't have a spot over there that is particularly dry. I haven't spent much time over there. I've been in London twice. Actually, only been in London to walk around London once, and that was only for 2.5 days. And it rained on us a little bit. Got out to Greenwich, stood on the prime meridian, stood on what the line on the ground says the prime meridian, and tried to find what the GPS said was the prime meridian, which was a couple hundred feet away. So I'm glad to be doing the European show today. The promos, the early ones in European and African, I guess, time zone evening. So good to be able to do a show for you guys at this point. Pat's wondering, it would be interesting to see the numbers in each call area. He forgot how big Foreland was. I don't think that statistic is hard to find. I don't think I'm going to take the time to go look for it right now, but it's not that hard to find. I did look at something that was interesting. Maybe I can dig this up pretty fast. Ham radio zip code map. I was curious if there were any other hams in my neighborhood. I'll stick in my, they want a call sign. Stick in my area, and this is what came up. So this is the somebody went through the effort of making a Google Maps connection to the ham radio license base, and. So let's see, there's me, and I can tell my neighborhood. My neighborhood is not geolocated on this map, but I'm at the very north end of it here. And the neighborhood, as defined by the homeowners association, you know, I'm in something called the Carolina Orchards neighborhood, the dividing line is right down that area right there. So this guy over here, KB2UEK, is not in my neighborhood. And I'm at the very north end of it, and it goes down this road, Carolina Orchards Boulevard, and then a little bit left and right. And so I don't know who this guy, WD4ASE, and I don't know this guy, K4JGB, but they both live in Carolina Orchards. So sooner or later, I will toss them an email, and that I'll, you know, pick out a QRZ, get their email. So these guys over here, they're nearby the neighborhood, but they're not in my neighborhood. It's kind of described by what I'm bounding here. There's a lot of hams nearby, and you might be curious yourself to go see where, hams are near you, plotted out on a map, which makes it easy. Haminfo.tetrans, TETRANZ.com. But I just looked, I just did a quick Google search for ham radio operators by zip code map. And then that'll get you to it, because remembering URLs is hard. Remembering Google searches is not that hard. So it could be fun. Find out if there's some hams near you that you didn't even know lived near you. Now, I don't know if these guys are active. This is a retirement community. It's a highly antenna-restricted community. I haven't seen any beams go up on top of any of those houses. But it'll be fun to maybe meet with those guys for coffee or something sometime. Chat about ham radio. Let them know that there is a ham radio YouTube star right in their neighborhood. I bet they don't know. What else have we got? We're done. The chat room has emptied out. Got 15 people watching. We have reached Promore territory. So come back tonight. There we go. I'm going to try to put my hand up and point directly at that sign. Luck. Live Sunday tonight, 7 p.m. Pacific. No, yeah, 7 p.m. Pacific, 10 p.m. Eastern, 0300 Zulu, technically Monday morning. That would be for you, RF Shortwaves. Don't expect you to see that show until maybe sometime later in the day on Monday as you play back the recording, because it's going to be in the middle of the night for you. And we will see everybody then. We had David here for a minute. I'll remember David by title. I'm Gary Pierce, K4AAQ, the apparently sleepy king of ham. Over and out.